How are you? It's Kristyn Burtt, and I'm here in Long Beach today at the LA Classic Chevy Club Show. You know what we're going to do? We are going to talk to the owners of some of these vehicles. We're listening to some great music, and of course, we're going to check out all of the cool cars. All right, I am here with Jerry Mull. He is the president of the LA Classic Chevy Club. Did I get all of that right?
You got that right, exactly.
Woo, five times fast, you can't do it.
No way.
Now, I want you to tell me all about the club. How long has it been in existence?
We formed this club back in March of 1988. And it all came out of a need. Actually, I bought this car, and I needed something to do with the car. And
so you started the club?
Yes, I started the club. So me and some other people, we got together. So we had like eight people when I first started, mm-hmm. And we decided, well, let's do have a club right here in the Southern California area here near LA. And let's call it the LA Classic Chevy Club. And it all caught on. We had a meeting and we had 57 people show up for that first meeting. And then 27 people joined that very first day. And it's grown from there. We have about 100 members now. We have members from about 6 or 7 different other states as well, including Washington, I think. We have Oregon, we have Arkansas, Oklahoma, New York.
Are people all owners of classic Chevys, or are they enthusiasts as well?
Enthusiasts, and we highly recommend that people would join a club like ours to find out about what these cars are all about before they buy one, because they can have a tendency to spend a lot of money on a car that's not very good, and it's better to get into a club, start networking with the other club members, get to know the club members, and start finding out where you can go to buy cars, where you can go to get service, parts, upholstery, that sort of thing, chrome work done, and they can network, and they can end up getting themselves a much better deal and a much nicer car at a lower price. So it really works out good. And plus, they meet some of the greatest people around.
Of course, I've met some great people here today. This is an annual show for you?
This is our 12th annual show. This show is, by the way, a very unique show. We think it's the only one in California which is strictly 55, 56, and 57 Chevys. A lot of the shows are multi-make shows or multi-year shows where they have a lot of our show is a specialized show, which is pretty unusual in Southern California.
Okay, yeah, and why specifically 55 through 57?
55, 56, and 57 Chevys are considered amongst the hobbyists as the so-called classic Chevys. The terminology is the classic Chevy. And then there's 58 to 64 Chevys are called late great Chevys, for example. Okay. So for some reason, the 55 to 57 Chevy is a car that, if you talk to most people, they say either they have had one, or their aunt had one, or their uncle had one. Somehow they relate to it.
And is it the classic body style? Is that what it is? And the engine? And
the 55 Chevy was the first Chevy to come out with a V8 engine. Yep. So it's actually 1919, apparently, they had a V8 engine, but that didn't work out. But then Chevrolet had a 6-cylinder all the way up to 1954. So this 58 V8 engine, which you see in here, it's the first year, big deal, because then all of a sudden they were the fastest and the hottest little cars on the street. But then your 56 Chevys came along and they one-upped them a little better. They got a little bigger engines in them, and they restyled the car. It's the same basic body style, same basic car, but did a restyle. 57 Chevy, once again, is, believe it or not, mostly the underpinnings are the 55, 56 Chevy. It's just the outer skins are different on the fenders and the grill and a few changes. But the basic body, it's the same vehicle. So it's amazing. It's the most successful makeover in automotive history.
Tack it up, buddy, gonna shut you down. It happened on the strip where the road is wide. Two cool shorts standing side by side. Yeah, my fuel injected Stingray and a 413. Revving up their engines and it sounds real mean. Tack it up, buddy, gonna shut you down. Declining numbers at an even rate. At the count of one, we both accelerate. Start, dodge is whining out in low, but my fuel injector Stinger is really starting to go. To get the traction, I'm riding the clutch. My pressure plate is burning, that machine's too much. Surfing now, everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me. Come on a safari with me.
Early in the morning we'll be starting out. Some honeys will be coming along. We're loading up our woody with our boards inside and heading out singing our song.
Come on, baby, wait and see. Yes, I'm gonna take you surfing. with me.
I'm here with Joe Varela, and he is president of the California Nomad Club. Is that correct?
That's correct.
I want to hear about what your club does that's a little bit different than, you know, the entire classic Chevy Club.
Well, we're the Southern California Nomad Club that we preserve the restoration of 567 Chevy Nomads. And also we do have honorary members who also own 55 through 57 cars and hardtops and what have you.
Now I want you to tell me about your vehicle here. This is a 1956 Nomad, right?
That's right. It's my 1956 Nomad. I've had it for like 4 years now. I built it and it took me 2 years to rebuild it, what I had it. When I bought it, some of the stuff was done on it already, but it had to be redone.
Okay.
It was previously stored 6 years prior to me getting it.
Okay. So now you mentioned to me that it's modified. So what do you mean by modified? I want to know what modifications were made on this vehicle if people don't understand that at home.
What do you mean by modified is the engine's been totally redone. It's a Chevy 350 V8, bored out to be 300 horses. I have not measured the torque yet, but
I did ask on that.
we'll do that someday. It's hooked together with a 400 turbo transmission, which really gets up and goes. So you can get out of any sticky situation on the highway, which sometimes I've had to do that. And
it's crazy driving here in California. You guys don't even want to know.
Yeah, you really want something like that in these cars so you can get out of the way.
Absolutely. Now mention a little bit about the paint job in the interior, because I know that was modified.
Yeah, the paint job originally on this car was an all-black car. Of course, I believe if you own a 56, either year, a Nomad or hardtop, the best way to have a 56 is two-tone. So what I did is I took a little bit of the interior, which came crocus yellow and black, and took the crocus yellow and put it on the back to make a two-tone. So far, I've seen one of a kind, only this way that mine is, which I'm so glad that I have the only one that color, and I get a lot of compliments on it.
That's great, and it is nice to have one of a kind because that really makes your vehicle very unique.
Yes, it does. And the other modifications I've done are the Budnick billet wheels that I've added to it, and I've dropped the suspension 2 inches all the way around.
All right. Now, this is what I want to know, because I know what my vehicle looks like, and it's a 2000. How do you keep your vehicle so pristine? How do you store it?
Well, a lot of hours of cleaning, buffing, and having my wife and kids help me also. I'm a little bit of a bigger person, so I can't get in the low spots where since I lowered it, it's a lot harder.
So you put your four kids to work, right? That's the way to do it, you guys.
Yeah, it works that way.
And then do you store it in a garage? Is it covered? What happens there?
Yeah. I have a California car cover on it, which resists moisture and everything, so nothing gets to it. It's covered up, locked up in my garage.
I'm going to need your kids to come over and do that to my car, because I have so many door dings and everything else.
They're great. They're great.
They're good. I should hire them, right? Now, you've got to tell me, are the kids allowed to touch the car?
Absolutely not. And they know that's Dad's golden rule. You do not get near your car. No bicycles in the garage. No scooters. No nothing of that type. And actually, past that garage door is off limits.
And Joe has spoken. Can you believe that? I wouldn't want to get near that either.
I love the colorful clothes she wears and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of a gentle wind on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
somehow closer now. Softly smile, I know she must be kind. In her eyes, she goes with me to a blossom room.
I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
We have Dale Conover here with us. You're owner of this 1957.
Yes, I am. Thank
you. Nomad.
Yes.
So tell us a little bit about it, because there's an interesting history behind the Nomad. There was not a lot produced. It was produced, what, 1955 to 1957?
Correct. You know your cars.
I try.
The Nomad was a loser for General Motors and Chevrolet in particular. I like to call the Nomad, it's Chevrolet's Edsel. And the reason I call it that is they were looking for a market that really didn't exist at the time. They were looking for the young married couple that wanted a little style. They'd been raised as children in mom-and-pop station wagons, so that had a stigma. They wanted a car with a little style, a little flash.
Now, the Nomad had the style.
Nomad had the style and had the flash.
But what's the problem?
It bumped the price $400 to retool it, and $400 today would be no big deal. We lose that in taxes. But back in the 50s, it was a deal breaker. And so that young married couple that wanted it desperately ended up buying the conventional wagon. So the number of units produced in 55 and 6 and 7 just continued to decline. So in 58, what we call the true Nomad disappeared.
Dale was telling me that he didn't do any of the mechanical work on this vehicle. Who did it for you?
You promised you wouldn't let my secret out.
Shh.
I'm very blessed that I have two sons that are mechanics by trade. Or at least they used to be. They're now in another profession, but they were mechanics mm-hmm. for years. Mm-hmm. And so they did all of Dad's mechanical, electrical, and a lot of assembly, not only on this car, but two other classic Chevys that I own. Because they say, Dad, you are mechanically retarded. Don't touch it. You strip bolts faster than anybody we know. So just be patient. Let us do it for you.
Okay, if you're mechanically inept, though, I want to know, how did you get involved in collecting, then, these vehicles?
Excellent question. One of those two sons in high school drug home a 56 Chevy. And he took auto shop, and this car that he towed home, put it in my driveway, leaking oil all over the place. I looked at it and thought, good grief, what are you thinking? It looked awful, it looked terrible, and I really didn't think he would see it through. But he finished his shop course in high school. It was his senior project. When it was all painted, I thought, gotta have one.
This is a present for Dad, right?
Yes.
And I hope he got an A on his project.
Yes, he did, as a matter of fact.
Aww, aren't you a proud dad?
Yes. If everybody had an ocean across the USA, then everybody'd be surfing like California. You'd see them wearing their baggies, Huarache sandals too, a bushy, bushy blonde hairdo. Surfing USA. You'll catch them surfing at
Inside, outside USA.
Ventura County line.
Inside, outside USA.
Santa Cruz and Trent.
Inside, outside USA.
Australia, Caribbean.
Inside, outside USA.
All over Manhattan.
Inside, outside USA.
And down Bohini Way.
Inside, outside.
Everybody's got
surfing.
Surfing USA. We'll all be planning out a real soon.
Ooh.
We're waxing down our surfboard. We can't wait for June.
Ooh.
We'll all be gone for the summer.
Ooh.
We're on safari to stay.
Ooh.
Tell the teacher we're surfing. Surfing USA.
Ooh.
And Anchor Bees and
Swan. Inside, outside USA.
Pacific Palisade.
Inside, outside USA.
San Onofre and Sun. Everybody's got surfing USA. Yeah, everybody's got surfing USA.
Well, that's it for us today in Long Beach. I hope you had as much fun as we did. I'm Kristyn Burtt, and I'll see you next time.